you very much again.
Okay. Thank you, Sylvia and Daniel, for the invitation, for putting together this very nice meeting, or rather a series of meetings, because it's going to be 3 days, right? So even better this way. So this is my title, Convex Integration for the Monge-Ampère System. And I'm going to explain what I mean by the Monge-Ampère System. In fact, it's a new system of PDEs that I want to do math analysis about. And this is just a preliminary talk in this direction. So this is sort of the story behind my research in this direction. In 2017, so a little while ago, together with Reza Pakzat, we proved the following result. The result says concerns the Monge-Ampère equation, so that we are all familiar with that PDE, determinant Hessian V is the unknown function, equals to the right-hand side given by F. And here in this theorem, which I'm going to explain in detail, but I stress the assumption is that the situation is two-dimensional, okay? So I'm looking at the solutions determinant Hessian V equals F in a set omega, and omega is a two-dimensional domain, open bounded, you know, simply connected. The theorem says the following: choose F, which is just in L2. In fact, it doesn't have to be in L2. I just give the statement of the theorem in the simplest possible manner. So take a scalar function F, and it can be very good, for example, constant equal to 1, or very bad from the Monge-Ampère point of view, constant equal to negative 1. Or it can be, you know, just an L2 function, something oscillatory. Okay, really anything. And consider determinant Hessian V equals to F. There is no boundary conditions. Then the theorem says that if you fix an exponent alpha, and you need alpha being less than 1/7, but just completely arbitrary alpha like that, then the set of C1 alpha, that fixed alpha, solutions of this problem I'm discussing, the set of solutions of this regularity is dense in C0. So that means that every continuous function on a two-dimensional domain omega, okay, every continuous function can be uniformly well approximated by exact solutions to this problem where F is fixed and regularity exponent alpha is fixed. Okay, so this theorem, in fact, is an installment of the so-called flexibility for the Monge-Ampère equation, and is proved using the convex integration techniques. And there are also the other sort of endpoint results regarding the rigidity for larger exponents when alpha is bigger than 2/3, but I'm not going to discuss. So now, you know, once you see a strange result of this type, I'm going to discuss it in this result as well in more detail. But when I was giving talks about this result and also the larger context, invariably at the end of each talk, I'm getting a question. Does this theorem generalize to dimension higher than 2? So my talk today is about this. And the answer to this question is yes. It does generalize to domains and to Monge-Ampère type problems in dimension higher than 2, but you have to know what you're doing. So this will not be about Monge-Ampère equation in higher dimension, but a new type of PDE, or rather a system of PDE, which here we define as Monge-Ampère type system. And this is a work in collaboration with King Han from Notre Dame University. So the motivation comes from, you know, a totally different topic, different mathematics that I've been involved with for the past 10 years or so, relating to non-Euclidean elasticity, dimension reduction via gamma convergence, where the Monge-Ampère equation, this equation, emerges as the so-called effective geometrical constraint in certain energy scaling regimes. So let me very briefly give you this motivation, and then we will pass to the appropriate generalization of the state. Okay. So in general, we look at thin so-called non-Euclidean plates. So I look at domains omega h, which is a Cartesian product of two-dimensional set omega and a you know, interval of small length h. Now on this omega h, I pose the following energy. So I scale by the universal thickness and I integrate on omega h certain energy density w, evaluated not as we usually do in nonlinear elasticity on the gradient of the deformation uh. So by uh, I denote a deformation, a vector field, three-dimensional vector field on omega h, because omega h is a three-dimensional domain, right? Two-dimensional midplate omega times the third normal direction of thickness h, but on the product of gradient uh with a certain prescribed tensor, which I call ah. Okay, so think that ah is a distribution of a 3x3 symmetric matrix field, which you can think in terms of geometry as the square root of the Riemannian metric that is imposed on the referential configuration omega h. And then you are taking away from the deformation gradient this this ah. Okay, so this is pertains to the multiplicative decomposition in description of pre-strained materials and so on. So there's a long story behind this functional. And now we want to understand, so the final question is sort of how does this energy scale? Can I guess the scaling of its of the energy on the on its minima? Does it scale like h to some power? And can I describe the asymptotic behavior of the minimizers or approximate minimizers of this energy? Okay, there's lots of questions, lots of research done in this direction. And a typical example of a result which directly leads Pablo Ochoa, who is another speaker in Sylvia and Daniel symposium. I don't know if he's in the audience because I don't see all the pictures, but I am very happy that he will also be giving a talk in a week or so, if I remember. So this is a theorem, right? So this is our functional here. Now assume that your AH has a particular form, that it is a perturbation of identity. Okay, so this identity plus thickness to some power, doesn't matter, there's some, you know, power has to be between 0 and 2, plus, so thickness to some power times S, and S is completely arbitrary. Okay, so it's just a perturbation of identity, right? This is what you are taking away from the gradient in order to compute this energy, okay? So now the statement is as follows, there are no further assumptions. Your energy, the minimizers, the infimum of this energy, scales in a certain manner. Okay, and if I was giving a larger talk and a talk on a different context, I would be exactly telling you what is behind. It's not just a random scaling h to power gamma plus 2. Okay, there is, one can understand precisely what is going on here, but this is besides the point. So if the energy scales in a certain manner, if and only if there exists an H2 solution to the Monge-Ampère type equation, which is given by determinant Hessian V equals to the right-hand side, which is given by the S, which is this perturbation of identity here. And it turns out to be, don't worry, on the next slide, I explain how it emerges, to be curl of tangential minor of this S. Okay, moreover, the energy scaled by its appropriate magnitude, gamma converges to the limiting functional, which is like biharmonic function, biharmonic energy under the constraint. So this is the essential message from this theorem, that I'm getting the constraint in very nonlinear in terms of the Monge-Ampère equation at this regularity level, where the right-hand side can be read out of S, so out of the perturbation of this incompatibility tensor that defines the energy. Okay, so how can I understand, again, this is just all the appetizer, please allow me, all the beginning of I'm building up, right, the momentum for the result, for the discussion. So how does this Monge-Ampère equation at all emerge in this context? Okay, so this is how it goes. So you look at this energy, you want to minimize this energy. Essentially, minimizing this energy is you want that your gradient, that your UH is approximately isometric immersion of the metric which is given by AH square. Okay. So now, in the context of the proof, you check that minimizers of this energy, or approximate minimizers of this energy, have the following structure. First of all, the metric that this incompatibility tensor is a perturbation of identity. So it is natural to expect, but this is all proof, okay? So we are making an ansatz here, but in fact, this can be proved without any extra assumption. That the minimizer has the structure, also it departs from identity. Okay, so the UHs, which are the minimizers of the functional I introduced, look like identity plus, okay, some out-of-plane displacement, some scalar function v times h to some power, doesn't matter. Okay, so identity plus v times h e3. E3 is the, you know, direction, fair direction in R3. So now let us look, what is the metric that is the pullback of the Euclidean metric via this perturbation? So I have to look at gradient UH transpose gradient UH. Naturally, this equals to identity plus, now we compute a little bit, it turns out to be gradient V tensor gradient. So now I look, on one hand, I have the metric, Riemannian metric, which is given by this pre-stress tensor. I'm using a little bit of terminology, which might be, you know, not understandable to everybody, but bear with me, please, for a moment. So I need to compare this pullback metric, which is identity plus gradient tensor gradient, with a given metric, which is A transpose A, and A had a particular structure. So it is identity plus H times this S. Okay? And now I want to find V such that this metric is sufficiently close to this metric that is given. How close? As close as this energy bound, this energy level allows for. And this energy level is precisely such, and this is what you see in the proof, this is the fact, this is the point in this theorem, okay? This energy is such that the discrepancy between those two metrics, the given metric and the metric that is obtained by this out-of-plane displacement V, is such that they coincide at the Gaussian curvature, at the highest order level terms of the Gaussian curvature that I see for those two metrics. So what is the, so now I have to compute Gaussian curvature of this metric, which is identity plus something gradient, tensor gradient, and Gaussian curvature of the metric, which is identity plus S. And now the linearization of the Gaussian curvature is the operator curl. Okay, so if I compute Gauss curvature of identity plus something, then it is the curl of something, modulo some prefactors. And curl of gradient tensor gradient is precisely determinant Hessian. So the constraint, once again, the constraint that I see here is what I just said, it reflects the fact that the Gaussian curvature of this metric, which is h to some power determinant Hessian V, coincides with the Gaussian curvature up to higher order terms of the given metric, which is curl S. Okay, so let us now go back and let us try to understand how can I generalize this? What is really essentially, what is the meaning of those statements in higher dimensions? Before I do it, to recapitulate what I'm doing in two dimensions, right? So now I can, so here I was, here I had this determinant Hessian V equals to curl. Of course, instead of curl S, S was given, I can think I am just given a function F. And in fact, any function F can be written as a curl of gray, can be written, I'm sorry, as a curl of something, okay? In fact, this something, you know, can be computed explicitly as the inverse of Laplacian on F. So the formulation, the weak formulation of the two-dimensional Monge-Ampère equation, which comes from this heuristics that I just explained to you, is as follows. Determinant Hessian V equals to F is equivalent to writing curl gradient V tensor gradient V equal to curl of some S such that this gives me F. So this means that gradient tensor gradient minus S has curl zero. Okay, and it is a known fact that the kernel of the operator curl consists exactly of symmetric gradients. So now writing this using this Lagrange multiplier statement that I just made, this, the equation here can be written as gradient tensor gradient differing from the prescribed S by some symmetric gradient. Okay, so this is For me, this is the formulation, reformulation of the Monge-Ampère equation in light of the description that I've seen here, which really relies on matching Kerr-Kerr gradient, tensor gradient, with Kerr-Kerr of S, which means matching the Gaussian curvature of a metric that are the pullback of the particular deformations. Okay? So I will skip this slide. This is how, you know, how we start, back how we prove our convex integration results. So now what can I do in higher dimensions? Okay? So now I have an omega, which is an set in Rn, in R2, but arbitrary n. Now let's consider the deformations, which are the out of plane deformations. So UH will go from Rn to Rn plus one, and this one extra dimension is given by, you know, I look at the graph of a function that is given by Z. Okay? And now let's look, so the pullback again of this UH is gradient UH times gradient UH. This is identity plus, okay, gradient V tensor gradient V. So now let's compare this given metric, now this is an n-dimensional metric, okay, with a given n-dimensional metric, which is the perturbation of identity by something, by now n-dimensional symmetric distribution of tensors on your little omega. So now I have n-dimensional metrics. So before I had two-dimensional metrics, I was looking just at the Gaussian curvature. Now I have an n-dimensional matrix, I'm looking at the full Riemann curvature tensor. And now the linearization of the full Riemann curvature tensor at identity is given by the operator, which here in honor of Kerr-Kerr, I have called C2. Okay, and it looks like this. You compute, you are looking at your S, you take various entries of S, and you take all bunches of second derivatives of S in different directions, you put them together in a linear fashion, and this is C2. So the Riemann, the highest order term of the Riemann curvature expansion of this guy is C2 of gradient tensor gradient, and here it is C2 of S of my given S. Okay, in particular, exactly when I compute C2 of gradient tensor gradient, before it was Kerr-Kerr gradient tensor gradient, which was determinant Hessian, okay? Now it is given by the following system. So for every, right, so C2 is a table. So for every A, B, C, D, before I was in two dimensions, now A goes from one to N, S does B, C, and D. Basically what I do, I look at the Hessian matrix of V, and I take A, B row and C, D column. So this gives me a 2 by 2 minor, and I take the determinant of it. So I have a bunch of determinants of all 2 by 2 subminors of the Hessian matrix of V. This is what C2 does to gradient tensor gradient. Okay? Now when N equals 2 in two dimensions, okay, again, now if I take an arbitrary S, is another observation, C2 of S is precisely Kerr-Kerr S. Nothing else appears, okay? So of course, we have all A, B, C, and D, but this is the leading, the only relevant information, okay? And again, one proves a lemma that the kernel of the operator C2 precisely consists of symmetric gradients. So here I introduce the Monge-Ampère system. C2 on gradient tensor gradient, which consists of taking the determinant of this 2 by 2 subminors of the Hessian of V, equals to the right-hand side. Okay, so if this right-hand side is also C2 of some S, we will come back to this point in a moment, then by this lemma, this equation, this system means that gradient tensor gradient differs from a given S by a symmetric gradient, by some symmetric gradient W. So very quickly, I'm almost running out of time because there should be time for questions. So what is the interpretation here? So this is what I define as the Monge-Ampère system, okay? So the validity, so V satisfies, so given F, so let's say F comes from S, okay? Then V satisfies this, if and only if the matrix identity plus, that's what we've seen on the previous slide, at H square S, and the pullback of this deformation, the pullback of the Euclidean metric via this deformation, where V comes as the first order perturbation of identity coincide at the lowest order term in all the components of the Riemann curvature tensor. And that is that property, equivalent property to V satisfying this system, is further equivalent to the following, that V can be matched by a higher order in-plane perturbation W. So now W will be order V is a scalar function on an n-dimensional domain. Okay, here W is an n-dimensional vector, is an n-dimensional perturbation. It is an n-dimensional field on omega. Okay, so V can be matched by higher order, I call in plane, in Rn perturbation, so that those two metrics that before just agreed at the Riemann curvature tensor, they coincide precisely at the lowest order term. Okay, so this is interestingly equivalent. So to this condition, last condition here, equivalent to this condition, equivalent to the V satisfying the Mohsen perturb system. Okay, so very briefly, here I say when F is of the form C2 of S, when is F of the form C2 of S for some S? Before I was telling you that any little f, any scalar function f can be written as a curl of some 2x2 matrix field. Here is no more the case. You have, that's an easy observation. So the following two conditions are equivalent. F is a C2 of, is in the image of the operator C2, if and only if it satisfies a bunch of symmetry conditions, which are essentially reminding in their structures the Bianchi, first and second Bianchi identities and natural symmetries as well. Okay, so here is a theorem. Look at, right, so this is the system, equivalent Mohsen per system, equivalent when F can be written as a C2 of S to this system. And here comes the convex integration statement. So assume that you are given V0 and W0 that are subsolutions of my system. So such that gradient V0 tensor gradient V0 plus symmetric gradient W0 is negative definite with respect to that prescribed S. Right? You take completely arbitrary V0, W0, only that they satisfy this, right? So they are negative definite S. As matrix fields, if you want. It means that the right hand side minus left hand side is a positive definite matrix for each x in omega. Okay. Then there exists VnWn of regularity C1 alpha for any alpha less than 1 over n squared plus n plus 1. When n equals to 2 gives me 1 over 7. This is 1 over 7 from the equation in my first slide. Okay. Which converge uniform to my prescribed V0, W0, such that Vn and Wn are exact solutions to the weak formulation of the Mohsen per system. Okay? And the corollary out of this is the statement that resembles the first theorem I showed you on my first slide, namely, if you are given F, which is in L2, okay, the right-hand side, and I'm looking at the Mohsen per system determinant Hessian V with all bunch of subdeterminants equals to F. Okay, so fix capital F, fix alpha, which is better than this threshold exponent that I mentioned. Then the set of C1 alpha solutions to the system is either empty or dense in C0. I mean, it is empty when F is not in the image in C2, right? So this is just a trivial statement. But when it is in the image of C2, of the operator C2, then the set of solutions is dense. So this is the theorem that is established. And what is the work in progress? I don't have time to discuss the rigidity statement for the two-dimensional Mohsen per equation, but here this is vastly open. What is even the formulation, appropriate formulation of the rigidity statement, and what will be the Holder exponent threshold for this system, okay? Another question, interesting problem, consider a higher codimension problem, right? So I can look at gradient, not just gradient V tensor gradient V, but gradient V transpose gradient V. So V will not be a scalar field, it will be some n-dimensional field. Okay, so this also has a natural connection with the type of problems I've been discussing. So does this allow for a more efficient convex integration construction because I have a higher codimension? So what can I do about it? And therefore a higher alpha, higher exponent, a possible exponent alpha for flexibility results. And further, can I think of evolutionary problems here, which should be just by analogy to analogy, you know, related to the evolutionary problem of evolving Riemannian metric, right? According to some law, in the same way as convex integrations and this type of flexibility results for quadratic structures are used in the Euler equations for fluid dynamics. So I think it's a good point to stop. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Marta. So now, if anybody have any question, you can just unmute yourself and ask, or you can raise your hand and I can try to see if there's a raised hand. Okay, well, thank you again. Let's thank the speaker again. And